Who are we talking about?
The moon.
The moon. Okay. So, how did they make this story? See, the moon takes 27 and quarter days to go around the earth. Okay. So, when he is moving around the earth, he is aligned with a particular star constellation somewhere. Okay, there is a line. And where were you born? Where were you born?
Andhra Pradesh.
Guntur. Okay. Guntur, at the time you were born, Guntur, the moon and the star were in one line. Okay. So they calculate how the moon is moving. It's all mathematical calculation. Where the moon, when I was born, he was on the fourth phase of Jyeshta. Not the first, second, third, fourth phase of Jyeshta, you know. So how do they write a horoscope? They first determine this, where the moon is when you were born. Okay, the place, the moon and the star, they calculate. Then they look at the other planets, how they are looking at the star. If Jupiter is looking one-eighth, showing one-eighth of his face, or Mercury is showing one-third of his face, and something else is showing, Sun is showing something, Moon is showing something, so they calculate one-fourth of this, one-fifth of this, one-sixth of that, two-eighth of this, you know, and nine-tenth of this, and they make a drawing. And they say, as the planets move, change their position, this is what constitutes your life. Okay, that is like a chemical composition acting on your blood and your personality and what happens to you, etc. It's just it's the theory. Okay, and so as the planets change their positions, how your life changes, they make predictions. Okay, where imagination comes to play is in the interpretation. What is Jupiter standing for? What is Mercury standing for? How much will it influence your life? That is where imagination comes into play. And a lot of studying. It's diagnosis, isn't it? Diagnosis can be sometimes right, sometimes wrong. But that is how horoscopes are written. And so, how did they know to make a story like this? Because modern astronomers tell us the star Rohini, which is Aldebaran in Taurus constellation, is many, many million light years closer to the Earth than the other stars. Okay, so when the moon is moving under Rohini, he takes a little longer and is closer. So he's spending more time with her. Okay, so when the moon is moving under Rohini, it takes a little longer because it's closer. And how did they know to make a story like this? And I'll share other stories as I go on, okay? It's quite amazing. So we know all about Raugalams, we know all about Muhurtams, etc. Because of this positioning of the stars and because they are ruling us all the time. So we look at some of the creations on this star. This is S. Rajam's painting, but you must look at all this. Okay, he has taken from the Rigveda. I'll tell you about it later. Okay, so now let's look at it again. Look at the hair. It's standing horizontal. When can the hair be horizontal? When you're spinning, isn't it? When you're spinning, the hair can be horizontal. By keeping the hair horizontal, the artist is telling us, and the waist cloth flying, the artist is telling us that this is not a static pose. It's a dynamic pose. It's a moment in a movement. It's like a flash photography. He's moving. He's doing Bhujangatrasita Karana. Okay, he's bothered by the snake. And he looked at it and then he's moved it. But he's turning. Isn't it? So it's a moment in a movement. It is not a static pose. சோ நம்ம நடராஜா பண்ணிட்டு அப்படியே நிக்கிறோம் இல்ல கஷ்டப்பட்டு நிக்கிறோம் இல்லையா அதுக்கு ஒரு நல்ல பிராக்டிஸ் வேணும் யூ ஹாவ் டு ஸ்டெபிலைஸ் யுவர் ரைட் தென் மேக் யுவர் லெஃப்ட் லைட்டர் அண்ட் இஸ்ன்ட் இட் சோ யூ ஹாவ் டு ரியலி பிராக்டிஸ் டு கெட் திஸ் பட் லுக் அட் தட் பொசிஷன் தட் த ஆர்டிஸ்ட் ஹஸ் காட் and then you have stars all over and you have
flames
all over okay the prabhavali the chola branch of nataraja the cosmic dancer is one of the most widely known images of indian art this form of nataraja is restricted both in geography and time it is found only in south india and attained a canonical form in the 11th century why 11th century it's a question In 11th century, Chola kings commissioned so many huge Natarajas and presented them to the temples. Why did they do that is another question. Okay? Look at this. The wire frame is the same, but artistic liberties have taken for details. Isn't it? The wire frame is the same, but look at this one. How exquisite. And artistic details, the artist has taken the liberties to, you know, put his mark on the details. It is understood to represent the cosmic dance of Shiva, by which he alternately creates and destroys the world. The density of symbolic meaning lies in the union of these and other opposing forces in a single image, because it's both creation and destruction. It's both illusion and protection. It is opposing things in one single image. Look at this one. Look at this exquisite. I mean, just look at that. See, by keeping the face a little to the side, we are shown that it is a moving sculpture. Drum in the right hand is symbolizing creation, because from sound came life, they say, and protection by the front right arm, that is Abhaya, and destruction by the fire in the rear left arm. And you know, in Geneva there is an organization called CERN, CERN, yeah, it is looking at understanding the origin of Earth. So they have created a big lab under the earth, and they are using colliders to understand how earth originated. Government of India, when Karan Singh was the chairman of ICCR, gave them a big Nataraja as a gift. And this is how they have shown it there. Look at the way they have projected the shadow on the big wall. So I was telling you stories. Let's look at how some of the stories came up. Shiva is known as Gangadhara, okay? So Gangadhara, yeah? Dhara is what? Holder, like Sridhara, Muralidhara, Gangadhara, okay? So Gangadhara story, you know, or you all know the story? All of you know the story of Sagara and Bhagiratha? You all know the story? Yeah, I don't have to repeat, isn't it? Anybody who needs the story? Bhagiratha story? Okay. Huh. I'll make it very short. Huh? It can be elongated. It can be very shortened. There was a king called Sagara. He had, the numbers vary, some say 60,000, some say 10,000 sons or soldiers. He wanted to do Ashwamedha Yaga. Ashwamedha Yaga is when you decorate a horse and create a sacrifice, and you let that horse roam, and your army follows it. You can do that only when you are 100% confident of your army. Okay? When the horse crosses into the neighboring country, the king of that country will look at the strength of the army that is following. He will decide whether he wants to fight or be a part of this kingdom. Because he knows, if he fights, he may not win. So he will remove his crown and become a part of the invading army, because you need taxes. So you need to expand your territory, isn't it? For taxes. So they were winning many, many, many kingdoms. Suddenly the horse was missing. So where is the horse? Where is the horse? And they found it in front of Kapila's hut. Kapila was a sage who was doing tapas. You know that if we sack, according to our belief, if you sacrifice something, you get a power, some certain power. Gandhari had sacrificed her sight and she got that power of making somebody invincible if she looks at that person because she had sacrificed. So Kapila had sacrificed everything, food, and he was focusing, so he had this immense power. So he was meditating and they saw this horse grazing in front of his hut and they started abusing him, saying, "You have stolen our horse. How did it come here?" So avar apdiye kannu taranda apdi paathar. All of them were reduced to ash. Apdiye they were reduced to ash. That was the power of his sight. Then they had a descendant called Bhagiratha. Bhagiratha was very sad that they did not get proper funeral. Their souls must be still locked up in this. So how do I compensate that? He kept asking people and they said, if you sprinkle the water of Ganga on this ash, their souls will go to heaven. So they kept, but Ganga is flowing in the heavens. How do you bring her down to earth? So he meditated on Ganga. So when you focus so much on something, sacrificed everything else, Ganga couldn't, you know, that reached her. She said, "Oh my God, what is this tapam?" Because he is doing tapas. So she said, "What do you want?" He said, "You please come down to earth so that you can, I can take your water and pour on my ancestors so that their souls will go to, will get released and go to heaven." She said, "Look, I am willing to come, but the force of my descent will be so strong that the earth might disintegrate. So find me a space where I can fall and a strong space," she told him. So he didn't know what to do. He prayed to Shiva. Shiva said, "A mere woman and she can say this? She has that power?" So he said, "Okay, I open my locks, I stand on the Himalayas, come and fall on my head," he said. So Ganga fell on his head. He locked her up in his locks. He just put the river inside his head. Then again Bhagiratha begged. He said, "Please, I want the water." So he moved a little bit and the water started trickling down. And Bhagiratha led her across up to Sagara, which is Bay of Bengal. Sagara Island is there near Bangladesh, you know, just where Ganga enters the Bay of Bengal. This is supposed to be near Varanasi because the Gangetic plain, this ash is supposed to be near Varanasi. That is why people go like to go and get burnt there so that they also will go to heaven like Sagara's sons, like Bhagiratha's ancestors. How did they know? How did they make a story like this? Was Nirupama and me, we sat and we discussed. So we have come up with this, okay. Look at this Ganga coming down